Millions of workers across America just got a pay raise thanks to new minimum wage laws that went into effect over the New Year's holiday. 21 states just increased their minimum wage, affecting every region of this country. What those increases will mean is a matter of debate. The minimum wage has existed in the U.S. for more than 70 years, yet economists are sharply divided over whether it helps low-income workers earn a better living or hurts them by choking the number of jobs available. As a reminder, the federal minimum wage right now is $7.25. States' minimum wages range from $5.15 to $9.47. To hear multiple viewpoints, I sat down yesterday with two economists with two different perspectives. Joining me now are Diana Furchtgott-Roth, economist and director of economics21.org at the Manhattan Institute, and Jared Bernstein, a senior fellow with the Center for Budget and Policy Priorities. So, first, let me just start with the basic question. Who is going to be affected by these increases in minimum wage?
What we're going to see is that people who have skills that are under the new minimum wage, whether it's $10 an hour or $12 or $15, those people are going to find it a lot harder to find jobs. And that's the real disadvantage of raising the minimum wage, that people with skill levels under that amount find it far more difficult to get employed.
So I very much disagree with that assessment. I think there's going to be a lot of folks who are going to benefit from the wage increase. And in fact, we now have literally decades of research underscoring that point. But more specifically, the people who are going to be affected are not, as is somewhat typically thought, teenagers or families of rich kids or something. It's adults. Over 80% are adults. Most of them work full-time. About a quarter of them are parents, so they've got kids. About 70% have at least a high school degree. Maybe 10% have a college degree. So we're really talking about the folks that you picture when you think of the low-wage labor force, people who actually depend on their earnings, and particularly this little bit of a boost in their earnings, to make ends meet.
Diana, you were mentioning the $15 and $10. A lot of the states that are increasing their minimum wages are not even at that $9 mark or that $10 mark.
Exactly, yes. But when you have a minimum wage, as we do right now, of $7.25 an hour, which adds up in cost to about $8 to the employer, you have to have skills of up to that in order to get hired. So whether the minimum wage goes up to $9 an hour or $9.50 or $10, you do find that more and more people are squeezed out and that they can't get that first job. And if they can't get the first job, they can't get the second job. And it's just immoral in the United States to say that people with low skills are not allowed to work, that if you have skills under a certain level, you are not allowed to work in the United States. It's un-American. It's not who we are.
So it's been very, very American, actually, since the Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938, to have a wage floor on the economy, which we know is the minimum wage. I think where Diana and I differ is in the following. Diana is talking about the theory of wage determination. If you raise people's wages above a certain level, then somebody's going to lose their job. What is much more relevant in this case is the empirical evidence, okay? Now that we have something like 26 states with minimum wages above the federal level, about 2021 now increasing their minimum wages as we speak, we have something that's quite rare in economics, a kind of a pseudo-experiment where we can look at all of these different changes over literally decades now and evaluate the kind of claims that Diana makes. And what we find is that they simply don't bear out.
So what is the benefit to the economy?
There was a new study that just came out in December by two professors at the University of California at San Diego. And it showed that when the minimum wage went up the last time from $5.15 an hour to $7.25 an hour, low-skill individuals earned about $100 a month less in the year following the $7.25 and $150 a month less in the 2 years following that, and that fewer people were employed. So yes, there are studies that show some things, studies that show the other. There are teens who can get jobs at $7.25 an hour who wouldn't be able to get jobs at $10 an hour. Right now, only 3% of working Americans are making minimum wage. So you can do a lot of aggregate studies saying, does it go up, and not find a whole lot of effect on most people in the workforce, because 97% of employed Americans are making more than minimum wage. Not because the law says so, but because employers have to pay them more to stop them moving to other jobs. It increases inequality if poor people cannot find jobs.
So, let me just say one point. That I factually disagree with, because there have been considerable studies now, again, nothing theoretical, empirical studies showing that the increase in the minimum wage has actually lowered inequality. And that makes a lot of sense, because if you think about where all the growth has been going in the economy of really the last few decades, it's largely been eluding low and middle wage workers and going right to the top of the scale. The minimum wage has helped lift the bottom a bit and help some of these low wage workers get a bit more of their fair share of the growth that they themselves are helping to create.
Okay, so what about that idea that basically there will be a ripple effect in both directions? One, when you say, for example, that low-skilled workers aren't going to be able to enter the workforce, and then he's also saying, well, it might actually have a ripple effect in that if I have to now get $9 an hour, the person who already was making $9 an hour at grade number two or grade number three, they're going to have to get a bump up as well.
Everybody knows that you don't hire somebody if they're not worth the amount. When you're paying more, you're hiring a different kind of person. Look at Chili's restaurants, for example. Chili's restaurants are putting in place iPads and kiosks so you can order without servers. So you change your mix of workers and technology. But again, the people who get hurt are the people with the low skills who then can't get that job at Chili's because there's been an iPad that's taken the place of the job. Or you go to CVS.
Jared, what about the other idea that employers are going to start maybe hiring at exactly the threshold where they can keep someone at part-time or keep someone if they have to pay a higher minimum wage? Maybe it's a boost to employment, but not the kind of employment that we really would like to see.
Well, again, I think if you go back to the empirical research, what would be implied by your question is that employers will significantly alter their hiring practices. They'll hire more part-time workers, or as Diana suggested, they'll hire higher skilled workers. They'll hire away from less skilled workers. But again, the empirical evidence shows none of that to be the case. What we find, for example, the Congressional Budget Office, widely agreed to be the nonpartisan arbiter of these kinds of arguments, found recently that if we raise the minimum wage to $10.10 an hour, that's the federal proposal over 3 years, phase it in, 24.5 million people would benefit, 500,000 people would be hurt. So I'm granting that point. That's a 49-to-1 benefit-to-cost ratio. Again, the point is not that you'll have more part-time or more higher skilled workers. That hasn't been the case in all of this multitude of experiments across the country. It does what it's supposed to do. It gives low-wage workers a bit of a bump.
So in any conversation about minimum wage, there's always a lot of information, a lot of data. What we'll try to do is we'll put both sides of your argument online for people to go and investigate themselves and say, where did he get that number? Where did she get that number? All right. So Diana Furchtgott-Roth, economist and director of economics21.org at the Manhattan Institute, and Jared Bernstein from the Center for Budget and Policy Priorities. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.
It's great to be with you.